Folks, welcome. Well, let's get this under the way straight away. Look, thank you all very much for showing and coming up. Much appreciated. Just get the show on the road. We'll just do acknowledgement of traditional custodians. The University of Newcastle respectively acknowledges the traditional custodians, the Wabakal people, on whose traditional land this town hall is located. Now, to introduce Mike Curtis, I think you probably all well and truly know by this stage, Mike is the project director for Newspace. Mike is an old builder, I suppose I can call him that. Mm. Can I call you that? Yeah, an old builder, I suppose. Similar sort of backgrounds to myself in respect, so we have our little discussions on the industry and whatnot, so some things we agree upon.
Some things we agree upon.
Mike Curtis is currently employed as Hansen Yuncken Senior Project Manager at UN's landmark Newspace Business and Law School project in the centre of Newcastle. He is a highly experienced construction professional who has enjoyed both executive contractor and client representative roles in the design, construction, management of complex capital projects both in Australia and internationally, England, Nigeria, Vietnam and Malaysia. In his capacity as Hansen Yuncken's leader on Newspace, Mike offers a project experience and liaison between clients, stakeholders, regulatory authorities and designers, plus proven expertise in planning, problem solving and project delivery. Fundamentally, he provides an expertise in buildability, being adept at project construction management, organisation and the practices required to implement a project efficiency effectively, I should say, and safely from inception to completion to deliver a quality project. His experience spans the gambit of hard money, tender design, construct, negotiated turnkey construction management, and managing contracted projects including hospitals, hotels, rail, airport infrastructure, office buildings, residential development, industrial and process development, and civil infrastructure. Woof, that's a mouthful.
It is a mouthful.
Yeah, you've done well.
It
has, yeah. How long?
Long time.
He brings to Newspace project skills and adaptability derived from hands-on experience at senior project levels and such organisations, Hansen Yuncken, Costain, Turner Corporation, I belong to that one, McNamara, Fletcher's and Transfills over a career spanning 50 years.
Yep.
Did you deal with concretes?
I have worked with concretes. I have been involved with quite a few people, but...
They're your main ones.
It doesn't. It says Costain, not concretes.
I said Costain.
Did you?
I did say. Did I say Costain?
Did you ask me?
I said Costain.
No, I added
concretes.
I know people from concretes.
Oh, okay.
Like Jerry Madison, who.
Okay.
He was their last manager here, and probably no, he wasn't worth employing. He worked with me once.
We got that settled.
A long time ago.
Okay, we got that settled. Ladies and gentlemen, let us welcome Mike Curtis.
Thanks very much. I won't make this an hour and a half like I did the other day at the university, for which I understand I'm notorious now. And I only got halfway through the subject matter. I am an old bloke, as it says there. I've been in the game 50 years. For what it's worth, I'll be 69 in about 2 months' time. And I'm lucky, like you, I'm involved in the construction industry. It's a wonderful industry. And it's taken me many, many places, as has been said just before. And one of the places brought me, for my luck, is here to Newcastle on Newspace. And before I start, I'd say in 50 years, I've done a lot of things. Some are hard, some are easy. I would have rated before this extending the concourse and the stations down at Flinders Street Station many years ago, 1985, when I had 250,000 people walking through the site morning, noon and night, and we couldn't stop a train. And I thought that was the hardest, really, because of the set out issues and working on, you know, building unions on railway union land. And that took in the likes, as has been said, of employment in other countries. But then I came here, and a bloke rang me up one day, and I just said this before, and said, I know you're about to retire, but look, can you give me 18 months, 12 to 18 months? And I said, on what? He's got this job down in Newcastle that, is that all right? Can you hear? I can talk without it, whichever way. And I said, why? He said, I think it might need a bit of nous. Anyway, I came here and I now understand, because I rate this job, New Space, as the hardest project, most complex project, and most intricate project I have ever been involved with. And that's in 50 years, and that's a big statement. It's a lovely project, as I think you'll understand when I go through. I don't know how much you know about it, so I'm not just talking about the building part. I'm going to let you see a little video of a walkthrough for those of you who haven't seen it, because the architects put something together. So without a lot more talk, and I'm probably easy without that, I might get on with it. If I can get this set up properly. Somewhere it says slideshow, there it is. Okay, the talk's by me, that we've just said. What I was going to talk about tonight, and I'm just sort of indicating, is New Space as a project, HY, that's Hansen Yuncken's involvement in it, and the things that make this project special, because there are some things that make this project very, very special. I've got both notes and put some G's against my talking, so as I flick around, guys, just bear with me for a moment and I'll get the sequencing right. Here we go. That's what you all see. That's the photo that is published for New Space. As you can see, it's a bit like a Salvador Dali painting. It's very, very unusual. It's exciting. The university's goal in getting New Space set up has been to construct a multi-level, technologically rich education building that will house the university's business and law facilities within Newcastle CBD. Obviously, I've copied that, but that's what this job is about. So for those who can't read, it is a new building of 14,000 square metres and the refurbishment of another one, a tenth the side university house there of 1,400 square metres. And it all has to be done in a very, very short time. There are quite a few facilities in these buildings, which you'll see as we go through, but basically it's creating highly adventurous, upmarket and highly technical educational space, which will be highly serviced by audio-visual facilities. And that you'll come to know as you actually live in it. You can't explain them. It's got great facilities. But looking at the space itself, at the end of the day, the plan is that it complements the university's business and houses on a daily 24/7 basis 3,000 to 4,000 visitors per day, which is quite a large population. And at the end of the day will be the raison d'etre for all the units that are being developed around here. So New Space gives credence to this whole regeneration of Civic. It is a major building in your town. It is an award-winning design by Melbourne Architects Lions in association with local architects here, EJE, who in my experience are doing a wonderful job. And I'll talk about that a bit as we go. The project is actually project managed for the university by Australia Pacific Projects, who are project managers some of you may know, and they direct us. And they respond to the infrastructure division of the university who provide all your facilities there. I'm very happy to say that we actually have, this is the first time I've worked with APP on any project, and I can say that I get on very well with their project manager. They're human beings. Now, it's not often you'll hear a builder say that about APP, I can assure you. Terrible thing to say, isn't it? But it's true. And you should know that about this job, because this job is special, I said to you. Everybody on it, the architects, the engineers, everybody are working together. It's a difficult job, and we'll come to some of those things. Running a project such as this, requires a large project team. This is the project team that I, heading up Hansen Yuncken, have at my disposal. I can't use that thing. You'll see that I'm somewhere in the centre there, but grouped all around me are a whole lot of people, all of whom contribute. The big blob in the middle is the principal design consultants. I can't see them from here. That's Lions, EJE, ACOM are doing the services, and Oricon are doing the structural. There are a whole lot of others who work in consultation. But within this framework, if you look, you'll see a few people you might even know, because there are a number who are graduates of your alumni here at UON. Assistant project manager up there, sort of to the right of that beautiful photo of me, is Jonathan Russell. He's assistant project manager, he's a graduate of your university, he's 32 years old, and he's a real gun. He just hasn't built or been exposed to a project of this complexity or size in this Newcastle environment. But after this, he'll be able to do anything, because it is complex. Just below the photo, and I'm going to move away from this piece. I want to point to this bloke, Tom Clark. He's currently one of your students. He's done all the engineering coordination of the structure, the design itself, and you'll understand why it's an exercise, the design of the architectural and the structural elements with the curtain wall that you see out there, the glass we hope to have finished one day, and the structural steel, the X columns and knobbies that you've seen lifted. Tom single-handedly has coordinated all of that. And it's needed one person because it's so complex, and I'll get to why in a moment, which one of the reasons is special. Down the bottom, there are other names of students here, or graduates from here. We also, as a company, offer engineering and also managerial expertise and various acumen, if you like, within the commercial side of the industry, which large companies such as us have. And to do a project like this, someone like me needs that size team. You can't do it with five people. It just doesn't happen. And it particularly doesn't happen if, as on this project, you have a short duration. HY's involvement on the project is basically, we are the designer-constructor. Originally, the project was won by Lions in a design competition. Having done that with the client, they got a DA, design approval, from the Department of Planning, not the local council here. After they did that, they went to tender, and we won it through a competitive tender. One wonders in the wisdom of that when you're trying to build it, but because I can tell you it's a big ask, it really is. Our responsibility is completion of all design documentation, so that's all the shop drawings, working drawings, the actual design development, because the schematic design is one thing, making it work has been a different thing. There's a lot of conflicts out there, and you can see that in the shape of things. Conformance of the design with statutory requirements. I could take you out to that building right now and say we have a problem there that we yet haven't resolved, and I will not get certification if it's complete unless we do. There's an area downstairs, two rooms, no, comms rooms or distribution rooms, that have so much ductwork going through across the top and going up the core that we can't get a fire isolating wall up, which we need to do between two rooms. We've been dealing with this matter for 6 months. Today I just said to the designers and to a certain project manager, Hansen Yuncken aren't doing any more about this. We're going to sit back now and let you come up with a solution, because you have to redesign the space and talk to the client. It's complex. There are matters all the way through. We come to the construction. Building it is normally the easy part, quite frankly, once you've let your orders. In this job, it's not, and we'll talk about that. You've seen knobbies getting lift, you've seen various things. You can see a curtain wall that needs completion, and I'll say just now, the original completion date for that was the 20th of August, just gone. And I'll come to the complexities of that and why it's special in this project. And then the last of all is commissioning the works. That is making sure all the AV systems work, making sure the compliance with the certification, making sure, in fact, that the client's brief has been satisfied and handing it over to the user groups. That's what a true design and construct does. And that's what we're doing here. That's our role. Under these arrangements, we're lucky because this time we have the designers now novated to us. And therefore, when push comes to shove and something's not working, I happen to have the power to make a phone call that says fix it or go away, because I'll get someone else to, and nobody can, you know, stop me from doing that, because I'm, at the end of the day, the bloke the buck stops with. I'm the bloke who gets the kick from the university and my firm. I'm the bloke who got the kick for blocking all of Hunter Street when we lifted up knobbies. It was me, I remember. But that's the way it goes. I thought you might like to see a small walkthrough of what you're finally going to get at the end of the day. And this is something we put together for our board. So they had an idea, and we had the architect do it. I'll talk to this. This is actually a composition put together by the architect. That's new space. And what may be apparent to you all of a sudden when you start looking at the size of the buildings around is how big it is. It is, before they put the top on Market Town down here, it is by far the largest building in this precinct when it's complete. It stands head and shoulders over everything, including the clock tower, by the way. It is taller than everything. It is a big building. It is, as you can see, a highly articulated building. It has magnificent views of the city. I don't know if you've seen all of this, so I thought I'd throw it in. It is going to be something very, very special. Some people like some things about it and don't like others. But that's the main entrance that you'll see off Hunter Street, and this is what you get when you walk in. There's beautiful spaces in it, and this is your facility that's being constructed by us. It has great places for people to sit, to study, to meet. Have you seen this before, anyone? Well, I thought you might like this. Is one of the lecture theatres. It's called the Immersive Theatre. It's a collaborative environment. It's a concept that is being brought into your educational facility. And it's going to be something, and is something, being marketed by the university the world over, and it will attract people. I'm lucky enough to have Liz, Liz is my neighbour, and it's very much her brainchild. He puts a lot into it. But you can see it's not just an educational facility, it's a complete change in this whole region and area, and it ties the new and the old together. That's the back, looking through the park here, just through there. That's a lane way off. You can see down past Civic, there's a lane that runs all the way through. And that's the front entry corner of Auckland and Hunter Street. It is a pretty nice building. So what's special about it? And why should I be talking to you apart from showing you a pretty thing? An architect can do that. It has these fantastic facilities. One, nothing is square. Two, it's a short contract period. And three, it's a complex building envelope. And in particular, the curtain wall design to achieve it has been very complex as well. So I thought I might just take you a little further and talk about nothing being square and explain it to you. Now, most of us know buildings like this. You walk in and the rooms are like that, and the columns are there. If it's a hospital, 8.4 metre grid that way, 8.4 metre grid that way, and straight down, and you can fit everything in. Just stand. As you can see from this, that's a square, that's a right angle, that's a right angle, that's a right angle, and that's a right angle. Not much else is. It's a set out nightmare. It has been like that from day one. That's the column grid. What's particularly noticeable if you look at the various grids is that there are also a whole series of grids that it gets built to. There's no common set of grids. So as a building exercise, my team, and that's why we've got that many people, have to come to grips with this, as do our surveyors. To put in perspective how difficult it is, I mentioned this to John before, on an average project, and New Space is worth somewhere 76 to 80 million when it's finished. On a project like that, a contractor would normally allow around about $40,000 for actual survey works. Then he site managers and leading hands have set it out. We're already at $160,000 for survey costs, not site, you know, reps, not supervisory staff. And we're two-thirds of the way through and still going. This project has far more set out content than any project I've ever seen. That's the foundations. That's the ground floor plan. I'm sorry about these being so light. I couldn't get them to print out darker. But nothing is square. I think if I go to the next one, that's level five. So we're now up above the ground, and you can see the continuity of what happens. I think that's a right angle there. A few right angle grids there, then everything comes in at different angles. Nobby's is constructed to about five sets of grids. So it's a fairly simple little building to come to grips with. But when you're out there building it, it's a nightmare. It really is. So what do you do? Using things like BIMs and iPads. My supervisors walk, they are educated. They walk around with iPads. They don't try to remember this. They don't carry paper. You need to refer to too much of it. They carry an iPad and they blow it up, they pull it off our server, and bang, they've got it. They know how to use things like basic coordinates. BIMs, some of them, I don't know how to use BIMs, I'm old, but they do. And they build off the iPad, and they tell people. Our subcontractors haven't got the confidence in that yet. So we have, in one of our major subcontractors, the fact that in getting the contract let, he wouldn't take on the obligation of doing shop drawings. Because he said, I can't do it. So we took it on, and we do it with him. It's a very complex exercise, and BIMS does work on this if we could all do it. We can't yet do it, so it's very complex. Nothing is square is the way I put it, and it demonstrates the complexity of the job. Taking that to its ultimate, that's the ground floor slab. That's in two dimension. It sort of indicates where different walls run at different angles, but as you can see, nothing is the same. Nothing is in order. And if you add a third dimension of that and realise some of these slabs are up and down all over the place, then you understand it's not your normal build. That's one of the things that's special about it, and we've come to grips with that and been able to achieve what we need to in doing it. We've got the set out right, our surveys are right, and I'll talk about that in a moment a little bit further. So nothing is square. The other thing you have to understand about this building is the way time impacts upon it. We have a very, very short construction period. When you look at the actual, the reason I put this up is just to explain the structure. In this earthquake type area, this building has a very large core, and the slabs hang off it, down through columns at various levels, onto pile pads, which are here, and there's a bridge pad there, where the actual column footing sits on top of it. So columns actually float to take up the vibration of an earthquake. And the building hangs like a tree, just the way you design a tree. All the floors hang off the core. So the core is quite massive. It is and has been a major element in the design because of its size. If we're looking at we decided because of time that we're going to post tension slabs here, and it was designed that way. But if we had to do the core in with them, the time it took the design to actually form and pour the core, given the story heights as well, because they're 4 metres plus 6 metres, meant that the time to do floor slabs became protracted out of all proportion. So what you saw us do here, and we based our tender on it, was use a jump form. Now, there hadn't been a jump form used in Newcastle, from what I can gather, for quite a while, although Oakdale, who the major formwork around here, they had a jump form, but we couldn't go with him. We decided to jump the form, and what we did is we therefore went for the core, and if that's the site, you can see there, is my pointer showing? No. This is the site, this is the core, the base of the core. It is quite huge. Because of time, we went for it first, having put the piles down, and we went back later to get the columns, because we needed to get that core above the slabs, otherwise it kept slowing us down level for level for level. So we paid a penalty in the first instance. And I will say this, when we actually got the contract, for the time we'd committed to come on site and our understanding of where the design was at, it proved not to be as simple as it was going to be, and we had a few rushes. But what we needed to do was get that core above the actual slab. So we set up a jump form. But all a jump form is a set of forms with a few climbing jacks. There are different versions. The person who does it best in Australia is American. He does very simple ones. Go down to Sydney and you can actually see them well done. Ours was a very cumbersome thing because of the size of the core. It's a massive core, much, much larger than normal because of this requirement for stability. So we got ahead, and that jump form up there, which finally got our sign on 3 weeks before I took it off, was one of the reasons we were able to get up with our structure very quickly. The other thing this photo shows is the space that was left on the site. And down here, the ex-con. Again, because of time, we in our methodology had decided to prefabricate the knobby structure, which is the thing we lifted. The size of this building and the size of the columns was such that it was impractical to build them piece by piece and put them up. They were designed to go up in one piece. Hunter Street and the space available to prefab outside of Newcastle and bring it in by Jigford was infeasible. We looked at the concept of floating them in fact, at one stage. Just too big. There's no space you can get these columns through. They're over 30 metres long, and they come equipped with the reinforcement in a tube inside. That was a massive problem, but it was overcome by a local contractor. We'll talk about that in a moment. But what we needed to do
was bring them in piece by piece. We brought them in. We thought around there, but we couldn't get. There's actually up here, there's a heritage light pole that nobody considered. So it's been a most interesting project learning about such things. So we brought it in down the street here, and there's a set of lights about one street away that, having turned into Hunter Street, the driver was brilliant. He missed the lights by 150 mil as he straightened up. Otherwise, it wasn't just traffic we were up for.
So we brought them in, we put cranes together and we lifted them over and we erected them there, or we assembled them there.
And that's the first part. So we needed the space. The site looks as though it's got space it didn't have. Let's go to the next one. That is the deck happening. It's out of sequence, I'm sorry. And then what you can see here is
that's a 120-ton crane, it's not an 80-ton crane. Forges, a local company, have done all our lifting. They've done an excellent job. They provide an excellent service and work with us. And that's one of the things this job has needed. It's been one of the exciting things. It's local contractors working with us. And your town's got that. And it makes it special, because quite often you get buggery off the table. These people have been very proactive. 120-ton crane set up with its outriggers took up a lot of the site. We couldn't set that up out in Hunter Street. It was infeasible. But we needed to lift up the 30-metre thing that we call MC1, which is the X columns out there. Later, we poured them with concrete, which we poured from the bottom up. Which is why if you, after Nobby's was there, you one day saw all this grey staining down. It was because the water of hydration came out after we cleaned everything, when everyone had gone home, and we came in the next morning and our beautiful pre-finished columns were all streaked. Nobody had thought about it. We thought we'd fixed it. Water of hydration just came out, as it does on your slab at home. The little things that you learn, and they're interesting things, they stay with you. But it was a complexity getting those in place. And I'll explain why in a second, because there is no tolerance in this. Those columns, and just hear of that, there is no tolerance in them. That's what makes Nobby's interesting, and I'll explain why as I go further. Nobby's itself. You saw, and this is talking about the spacing, and I'll come back and show you some photos and explain some things. One of the things that was interesting about Malton's, and that's the precast or prefabricated structure we put together in the space there, is that with the lifting here, it weighed just part of 100 tonne. We had allowed for one 350-tonne crane set up on site to lift it. The problem was that when we cut our methodology, we had the crane sitting here between the X columns and the building. Big building, X columns that had cost a lot of money to get in place, and this 100 ton structure that we're going to lift up that has 600 mil clearway between columns and building in a zone where the wind gets up to 90 miles an hour blowing around that building. It gets very high. So having planned it like that, and priced it, by the way, cost me a fortune, we said, no, we can't have these X columns not work. So we went about our homework and we finished up with two 500-ton mobiles in Hunter Street. This project is unique in having the first, in Australia that is, on a building site, twin lift 500 ton cranes lift in tandem. Hadn't been done anywhere before. If we couldn't have done it, I don't know what we could do. And the way it worked is, this crane's the leader. This crane is a buoy and follows along. So we lift up and turn.
We set them up overnight, and I go back. This might be the one I'm looking for. One of here we go. Is that showing a? I want to show you the lift because one of these has it. Oh, there we go. This is what actually happened when we did it.
We lifted it up. See how smooth it's going? It got up. We turned it around. Two cranes, one leading the other. Oh, look down there, I'm sorry.
I'll give you the next part of that. I don't know how this bloody thing works. And at the end of the day, it ended up against the building. Apart from the lift itself and the cranes, what was special about that
is it saved us 45 days of construction on the site. Because that's how long it would take having the birdcage and got up there and built the stuff on up high. But also, what's special is these cleats. There are 9 of them, plus the tops up here.
In total, those cleats have 124 bolts. The holes are 38 mil in diameter, and the bolts are 36 mil in diameter. So it's a zero tolerance construction. I don't believe it's been done before in Australia. And I can tell you when I was watching from my office as it came in, because I was in my office, I was pulling out my ticket to the Amazon because that's where I was going to be. And then all of a sudden I saw this man put,
there's one bolt that had to go in by hand just here, and it slipped in. And I pulled out a beer instead.
It's not been done before. So it was really special. And what was even more special is that's the typical cleat, and that's me standing beside it,
that we cast into our structure. And they had to all be perfect. Now in formwork that doesn't happen. And I found that out because I'd been assured the surveyor had checked it before we poured and after we poured. Then we put up the X columns and I said, I want a survey of those and that, just to make sure I'm right. One of the cleats had moved 19 mil from the top to the bottom. We had to re-engineer every one of the connections. We actually lost 2 months. That's our mistake on this job. Seeing it was on the critical path, it didn't make me happy at the time. And there had been over 2,000 hours planning in this exercise before we did it. But it's never been done anywhere else before on a building site. And it's been done by Tom Clark, Jonathan Russell, another guy who's Jono's brother, and a whole group of people from this place. It's something I'm very proud of, to be honest. It's something I'd not seen before, and you can tell your stories. Then there's a last thing in complexity, and it's this. This is the curtain wall. I'm watching my time, John, just as we go, because the curtain wall is a saga in itself. You've seen all the photos. The building is that shows the different shapes. It's not square. The curtain wall is actually fabricated overseas in Dubai and brought here. It has been put together by a company called JML, who are our local company, who, as we found out, or have found out since, not only promised themselves faithfully to us for the tender, but also to our nearest competitor. Unfortunately, we won them, but we're building it. Some of you will know what I mean by that little last comment. The curtain wall when designed or when tendered, was put together and put forward by my company and JML as a modified version of the existing British aluminium brittle design, which meant we didn't have to go through a testing regime. Some testing, but not a full curtain wall testing. For those of you who are unaware of curtain walls and regimes, if you start from scratch on a curtain wall on a major building and invent a new system, redesign the system, it will take you anywhere from 9 to 12 months to actually get a test passed. No matter what you do, that's what it will come back to at the end of the day. And you can go anywhere around the world in any country, and that's what it will pan out to be. When we took this project and tendered it, and I'll say this for JML as well, we put forward the fact that we were going to use this modified brittle design. There was only one little problem, and that little problem is these sunshades. The modified brittle design selected didn't have those sunshades in it. And the standard for curtain walls, if you go through the wall, requires, if you're going to put them in the building, you've got to have it tested. So, unexpectedly, we finished up going to places like Dubai and the desert and setting up a testing rig for the curtain wall, which is good we did. Because when it was actually tested, you can see water there, and it failed. This was all because of the way it was put together, and it was a different arrangement. It took us 2 months to get that passed, and this, by the way, is outside Dubai, and there's nothing there but dirt and dust and a highway with a million cars. I went to the third time it was going to be tested. I flew there overnight because I'd had enough of hearing secondhand what was going on, and I didn't know a bit about these things. It was going to go down. I arrived, having flown business class 13 hours, had a freshening shower, went to this place, had a look inside, and said, can the test, came back, and 2 months later they finally did it. The reason? They didn't know what they were doing. They hadn't followed the requirements and the specification. There's one thing that we've learned on this project. There was, is that the specification has a lot of fine print. And we've been held to it, and we hold our subcontractors to it. But when it was tendered, nobody realised that. You don't realise that at the time it's happening. It's what happens in a competitive market. But this curtain wall has been an absolute saga. So it cost us 9 months. And there we were back in February this year. It all got passed, and it's into production in time to be installed and erected by the 20th of August, just passed. And then a few sounds started happening, and we found out that JML went into liquidation. So we, this is what contractors on any project, it may not be JML, it could be a form worker, it could be a precast concrete, it could be a joint, what we all have to come to grips with. So here are we, Hansen Yuncken. We're going great in this structure, we've done knobbies and everything, we look terrific, the university thinks we're great, and I have to go along and say, we've just lost 9 months. We had a choice. That choice took us into a realm we never intended to be in, which was refloat a subsidiary of JML, which we did. We also spoke to the liquidator and got rid of any liabilities or obligations and got the ownerships that we needed. And we took on working with JML, which we are still doing, to get this building a curtain wall.
we lost 3-4 months. The alternative was 9 months plus a hell of a lot more money, because we would have been held to ransom. Now, I'm telling you the dirt of this, if you like, because that's contracting. And in about 6 months' time, my team will look back on this, and instead of talking the way we do occasionally at the moment about JML, we'll be laughing, because we will get that wonderful thing you get out of difficult projects, a sense of achievement, because we will have demonstrated in overcoming things like this. And I just want to show you this last thing. This is the result of visits to Dubai last July, again by Tom Clark, as it's his role. Every piece of curtain wall there is identified, scheduled to a ship. We had to get involved with their manufacturers because we found they were telling us fibs in the circumstances. Quite understandable. And we have got right into a process we never expected. Visits overseas, you know, night outs at the Sook, things like that. An awful cry and sooking because of the problems of scheduling the different deliveries, which is, and the black is Oracle. I have an engineer over there who's monitoring what happens, and the promises on the red, which are the scheduled deliveries, etc. And these are the very last ones, and that row there will be the last lot of curtain wall, because they're in our hoist bay, that we erect, and they will arrive here at the end of October. That is not too bad from the circumstances. So I came along tonight to give you an idea of, one, what the project was about, because I wasn't sure if you all knew, and also just to give you a little bit of an insight of some of the pleasures Hansen Yuncken have had in working on it. This has been quite an extraordinary experience, and I'm lucky enough to say that the people I showed you before have more than risen to the occasion in managing this project. The coordination out there, I could go into programming coordination, is quite extreme because of the different angles on everything and the way things go together. But these are the real issues, and these are the pleasures of building. Thank you.